Utah and northern Arizona have a wealth of scenic wonders in their national and state parks. This video combines several different trips to Utah to suggest worthwhile drives and hikes as you explore these parks. From Moab, you can explore several parks. If you're coming west on I-70 to get to Moab, be sure to take the Colorado River Road. We start at Arches National Park. I would recommend 2 days for this park if you want to do all the hikes. In 1 day, you can do all the drives and two or three short hikes. Soon after entering the Arches National Park is Park Avenue Trail, a moderate hike to Courthouse Rock. There's a short loop trail around Balanced Rock. Then explore the north and south windows as well as Turret Arch. A short distance away is Double Arch. One of the more difficult hikes is the one to Delicate Arch, or a simple hike to one of the viewpoints. Further up the main road are the Salt Valley and Fiery Furnace viewpoints. Then a short hike will take you to Sand Dune Arch and Broken Arch. As we drive to the Devil's Garden Trailhead, you'll pass Skyline Arch. The highlight of the park is the Devil's Garden Trail. This first part is easy to Tunnel Arch, Pine Tree Arch, and Landscape Arch. Then the trail gets more difficult to get to Partition Arch, Navajo Arch, and Double O Arch. You can hike back the way you came or take the primitive trail, but watch carefully for the cairns because it's easy to get lost. For Moab, you can also do both Dead Horse State Park and the Island Sky portion of Canyonlands National Park by taking Utah 313 north of Moab. On the way, you pass the Merrimack and Monitor Buttes. The point has several beautiful viewpoints. From the visitor center, you can hike to the Colorado River Overlook and then on to Dead Horse Point Overlook. Drive on to the Islands in the Sky portion of Canyonlands National Park. It's a short hike to Upheaval Dome with its grays and brown colors. The other interesting hike is to Mesa Arch with a beautiful view of Buck Canyon. At the end of the road is the Grand Viewpoint Overlook. You can see several layers to the canyon below you. Out of view, the Green and Colorado rivers converge. You can return to Moab the way you came, or if you're adventurous and have a four-wheel drive vehicle, take the cliff-hanging Schaefer Trail. Even when we reached the end of the cliffs, it remained an interesting road, going through many washes and cliff edges as we passed by dry streams that led to the Colorado River. Schaefer Trail is about a 2-hour drive to Moab. If you have another day, south of Moab is the Needles section of Canyonlands. Turn at the Ice Cream Sundae Formation onto Utah 211. Newspaper Rock is on the way. Three different cultures created the pictographs. From the car, you can see the Needles, Wooden Shoe Overlook, and Big Spring Canyon. I would also hike the Pothole Point Trail. Watch for wildlife in the potholes. The Cave Spring Loop is also interesting with its kitchen underneath the rock shelf. Finally, visit the roadside ruins before leaving the park. Our next series of stops is in southeast Utah. If you're coming from the northwest along Scenic Highway 96, be sure to stop at Heights Crossing in Glen Canyon's National Recreation Area. We'll make a circular route on US 191, 163, Utah 261, and Utah 95. Edge of the Cedar State Park is in Blanding. The museum here does an excellent job of explaining the ancient Puebloans. It points out that there were actually three different cultures in the Four Corners area, each with a unique style of architecture and pottery. In the museum was a sash made from Macau feathers. They also had a pottery jar, which shows a hunter shooting a stork. Stop at Fort Bluff Historical Site. While the cabins in this park are all newly built, each was crafted by descendants of the original families. Each has an audio track telling a story about the families coming to this area of Utah. Two photo stops on the loop are at Gooseneck State Park and the Muley Point Overlook. The highlight of the loop is Natural Bridges National Monument. There are three bridges, Sipapu, Kachina, and Owachoma. The hike down to the base of Sipapu is quite interesting, with two sets of stairs and two ladders.
We're in the shadow of Sipapu Bridge in Natural Bridges National Monument.
You get an idea of how gigantic this is. It's the second largest natural bridge in the US, next to Rainbow Bridge in Glen Canyon. There is a viewpoint for Kachina Bridge, and then a much easier hike to the base of Owachomo Bridge. A side trip to consider is the Valley of the Gods, a 17-mile dirt road that winds through various rock formations. A must-see is Monument Valley, where many westerns have been filmed over time. You can see the familiar rock formations on your own in your car. But we highly recommend taking the day-long Indian guided tour, which starts in Mystic Valley. The tour accesses both valleys, including petroglyphs and many arch formations. Thank you. We're going to head to the north rim of the Grand Canyon, but there are a couple of interesting stops along the way. First is Navajo National Monument. Here you can walk the Sandal Trail leading to the Betatakan cliff-dwelling overlook. The must-see, however, is Antelope Canyon outside Page, Arizona. This is on Indian land, so you need to pay for a guide and tour, but it's well worth it, and you can end the day at the Grand Canyon. The north rim of the Grand Canyon is 1,000 feet higher and much less clouded than the south rim. Remember, the road is closed from late fall till mid-May. Spend a day starting at the Grand Canyon Lodge and take a short hike to Bright Angel Point. Then take the scenic drive to other short hikes and scenic points. Point Imperial, Roosevelt Point, Walhalla, Overlook, and Cape Royal, with a hike to Angel's Window from Cape Royal. Next is Zion National Park and its nearby attractions. The drive through the east side of the park will give you views of Checkerboard Mesa and possibly Desert Bighorn Sheep. Just before you enter the tunnel from the east, take a hike to the canyon overlook. The must-see is Zion Canyon, which today requires a shuttle bus. Everyone should visit the Grotto, Weeping Rock, and the Riverside Walk. This flat trail goes through the narrows and then ends in the river. You can walk up the river as far as you dare. For those who want a challenge, take the steep hike to Angel's Landing. This is not for the faint of heart. It can get crowded. I didn't make it to the top because people were going two ways in a one-way section of the trail. If you have another day, there are two other parts of Zion Canyon to visit. Kolob Canyon is a beautiful drive off I-15. A second is the Kolob Terrace Road, which leaves Virgin, Utah, and provides views high above Zion Canyon. With a third day, you can visit Snow Canyon State Park outside St. George. I would recommend three trails here: the Petrified Dunes Trail, the Butterfly Trail, which is a lava tube to explore, and Jenny's Canyon. In St. George is the Rosenbrunch Wildlife Museum, a collection of the most bizarre animals from all over the world. Unfortunately, this is a game collector's trophy room. From Zion, take I-15 north. Stop at Kolob Canyon if you haven't already. Then head east on Utah 14. Cedar Breaks National Monument is a seasonal park. The road through the park, Utah 148, is closed from mid-November through May. We encountered snow in October and colorful leaves in another October. The park is a miniature Bryce Canyon, but with forests and lakes. Continue the drive to stay overnight in or near Bryce Canyon National Park. Let's view Bryce from the far end of the canyon. to Sunrise Point. Bryce Canyon is just filled with scenery, whether along the scenic drive or hiking the canyon walls or down into the canyon. There's a shuttle system available since parking can be a challenge, particularly in the Bryce Amphitheater area. Be sure to walk from sunrise to sunset points at either sunrise or sunset for spectacular views. My two favorite hikes leave from Sunrise Point. The Queen's Garden Trail heads down the canyon walls, and then you return via Navajo Loop through the Wall Street Formation to get to Sunset Point. Going the other direction from Sunrise Point is the Tower Bridge hike. We leave Bryce Canyon along Utah 12 on our way to Capitol Reef National Park. Just outside Cannonville is the Kodachrome State Park, named for the color and contrast of its 70 stone spires. An easy trail here is the Grand Parade Trail. Continuing on Utah 12, you reach Escalante National Monument. Be sure to stop at the turnouts for the scenery.
We're on Highway 12 in the Grand Staircase Escalante National Monument. And this is one of those million-dollar highways built in the late 30s to connect Boulder with Escalante. Previous to that, they had to take a mule train to get their mail once a week. You can see it's really wild country. This was actually one of the last areas to be explored in the U.S. And you can see the snow on the mountains above.
Next is Escalante Petrified Forest State Park. Hike the Petrified Forest and Sleeping Rainbow Trail to get a good look at the petrified wood. Finally, you climb Boulder Mountain to stay in Torrey, or better yet, the campground at Capitol Reef National Park. Capitol Reef needs it one day, but it's easy to extend that to 2 days. Start at the Fruta Historic District with its apple orchards, then take the scenic drive to its end and take the Capitol Gorge Road and Trail. Be sure to climb to the tanks, though they may be dry. On the way back, take the Grand Wash Road and Trail. Stop for petroglyphs along Highway 24 and hike to Hickman Bridge.
We're in Capitol Reef National Park. This is the view just past the Hickman Bridge. You can see the various strata. The various rock formations. Here comes Capitol Rock, which gives this area its name. That and the fact that the water folds here were near impossible to get through except for a few places. You can see the pockets caused by acidic water flowing through the rock. You won't quite see Hickman Bridge because it's that lower white formation right about here.
As the sun is setting, be sure to visit the Gooseneck Overlook and Sunset Trail, as well as Panorama Point. It requires a full day to explore the water pocket district of the park. From Highway 24, head south at Milton Bullfrog Road, then west on Burr Trail. Surprise Canyon is an easy hike and picnic spot. The Burr Trail takes you back to Highway 12, where you want to be sure to stop at the Anasazi State Park. Now you can complete the loop to Arches National Park by taking Utah 24 north to I-70. But there's one more stop to make, Goblin State Park. Take the hike into the valley, and if you have some extra time, do the Little Wild Horse Trail just outside the park for another example of a slot canyon. Dinosaur National Park along US 40 near the Colorado border is another park we highly recommend. The star attraction of the park is the Quarry Exhibit Hall. In the same region, take a tour of the Tilted Rocks, a 10-mile trip to take in some short hikes, petroglyphs, and visit the Josie Morris cabin. For a second day, start early and travel into Colorado to take the Harper's Corner Road. Be sure to take the hike at the end of the road.
We're at the end of Harper's Corner Trail in the canyon section. This is Whirlpool Canyon, formed by the Green River. And we continue on, and you can see the green again, and the canyon surrounding it. And now come into the picture is the Yampa River, which joins the green right at the tip of Steamboat Rock, which hides the junction right here.
If you have time, take the four-wheel drive down to Echo Point, which ends near that junction. The road has some very narrow sections as you descend into the valley. We hope you've enjoyed this tour of parks in Utah and northern Arizona.